This theme of fight the fight. And I want to go over our theme verse real quick. You guys remember our theme verse? We talked about it last night. All right, here it is. It's 1 Timothy 6:12, and it says this. It says, fight the good fight for the true faith. Hold tightly to the eternal life to which God has called you, which you have declared so well before many witnesses. I want to read another translation of that verse to you. This is in the Passion Translation. It says, so fight the fight for the winner's prize. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm going for the winner's prize. It goes on to say, lay your hands upon eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession before the multitude of witnesses. I wanted to share that version just because I thought it was neat. It said, fight for the winner's prize. We're fighting for the winner's prize. I want to share this other verse with you this morning. It's Ephesians 6. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. If you got your Bibles, you can turn there and take notes. But Paul, the Apostle Paul in Ephesians says this. He says, a final word, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. It says, put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand firm against the strategies of the devil. And this is the part that I want us to hear this morning. And it says, for we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies. We are fighting against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places. Somebody said, amen. Listen, if we're going to fight this fight, right? If we're going to put up our deuces and we're gonna knock out the enemy, right? If we're going to fight this fight, I want to share with you three things that we can practically do this morning and to know. Three things to know. I need you to do like this. Got you. Listen, there's three things that we need to know, okay? And we need to have laser focus on these three things. Everybody say laser focus. Got my eyes on you, Wazowski. Any Monsters, Inc. fans? Mike Wazowski. I'm watching you, Wazowski. That was pretty good. That was a, like, pat on the back. But we need to have laser focus on these three things that we need to know in our fight. I want to talk to you today about Yomi. You ever heard of that? Yomi. I'm probably saying it wrong, but it's Yomi. And Yomi, laser focus, is what we're going to talk about this morning. Look at your neighbor and say, Yomi. Yomi. Yomi is a Japanese word. It's a Japanese saying, if you will. And it simply means the ability to read your opponent's intentions before they actually act. So Yomi, the ability to read your opponent's intentions before they act. Laser focus. Say laser focus. Knowing how the enemy will trip you up is where we need to have laser focus. Think about this. The first thing that we need to know is we need to know the enemy. We need to know who our enemy is. Who is our enemy? Satan, right? The enemy, the devil, right? Lucifer, he's got man of many names, right? But we need to know the enemy. And so in order to know our enemy, we've got to go to training camp, right? We've got to go to the gym and get fit. So in our morning sessions, we're going to be like we're training for a fight, right? Like we're, you know, float like a butterfly, sting like a bee, you know what I'm saying? Rough crowd, you guys need to wake up a little bit. You need to high five the person next to you and say, you're the most beautifulest thing I've ever seen today. And then look at your other neighbor and say, man, you just just ugly. Well, they gotta be ugly if they're the one next to you on the other side's the most beautiful. Listen, we gotta have laser focus and know our enemy. Think about this. The enemy knows your weakness. The enemy knows your weakness. We talked about this in our small group last night. How? Why is it that we fight things that we continue to fight and we fight and we fight? Paul calls them a thorn in the flesh. Right? These things that you ask God for deliverance or you ask God to help you overcome and you still are struggling with the same things. There's some things in life that you are always going to struggle with. For me, it's not running to the kitchen every time I smell a batch of fresh brownies. Anybody else? Right? You're always going to have the struggle. But listen, there's things that we're always going to struggle. The enemy knows our weakness, so we have to know our enemy. You need to know this. Our enemy, Satan, he is real. He is alive. And the Bible says that he's like a prowling, roaring lion seeking to who he may devour, who he may destroy. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So we need to know our enemy. When you are in a fight with somebody, right? When you are boxing or when you're MMA, when you're Taekwondo, whatever the case may be, you are trained, right, to watch your opponent. You're trained to block their moves, to counterattack them. And so in the same way, we as Christians, as believers, we need to know our enemy. We need to know his every move so that we are able to withstand when he fights us, right? We need to throw them dukes up and ready to throw down. You know what I'm saying, Camp Wow. As long as we focus on our physical struggle, check this out. A lot of times in life, we focus on the physical struggles. We're like, man, this isn't working. I'm trying to do this, but this isn't working. As long as we focus on our physical struggles, the enemy wins. Because we're not fighting flesh and blood. We're fighting a spiritual battle. What that means is we've got to have the Word of God in us. We have to spend time with God. We have to spend time in the presence of God. We have to grow in the knowledge of God. Not just in the knowledge of God, but the application of God's Word and His Spirit alive in and through us. See, if we just focus on the physical things in our walk with God, basically making a checklist of, oh, I did this today. Oh, I did this today. Listen, we're always going to fall short. But when we make the connection to we are fighting a spiritual battle, right? We talked last night about getting ourselves out of the way and bringing our situations to the feet of Jesus and allowing Him to fight our battles for us. So we have to know our enemy in order to surrender some of those things. And you know, the enemy, he's like a cheap shot. He always hits us with the low blows because he knows our weakness. Listen, did you know that he has weaknesses as well? Did you know that Scripture says that even at the mention of the name of Jesus, that all hell has to flee? Come on, somebody. That ought to make you... If the enemy knows our weakness and we know his weakness, then we ought to be jumping and shouting the name of Jesus right now. Like, anybody wake up this morning just need a little bit more Jesus in their heart today? Come on. Even at the mention of the name of Jesus, all hell has to flee. Just the mention of the name of Jesus, my wife and I, we've been youth pastors for 10 years. And in the beginning of that, we youth pastored a rough and tough inner city church, basically, with non-church kids. And you never knew what kind of magic four-letter word was going to come out of their mouth. Rough and tough group of kids. But we had kids that were dealing with self-harming and things that we had never experienced before. And so we had to realize that we're not fighting a flesh and blood fight. We're fighting a spiritual fight. And so what do you tell a teenager who feels all alone, that they are just worthless? The only thing that I know to tell them is just at the mention of the name of Jesus, all hell has to flee. Come on, kid. Yeah. Listen, this morning, if you're struggling with depression, if you're struggling with anxiety, if you're struggling with fear, if you're struggling with self-harm or suicidal thoughts, or if you're struggling with addictions to pornography, whatever the case may be, know that that enemy that's attacking you has a weakness, and that weakness name is Jesus Christ. That enemy. greatest weakness is Jesus Christ, and He fights your battles. So we have to know our enemy. We have to know his weakness. If we want to win the fight and flip the scorecards on the enemy, pinning him down, come on somebody. If we're going to pin the enemy down, then we have to realize that we are connected to a God who is more powerful, who has more authority, who has the strength to pin the enemy down. We have to realize that we have a God who is greater than anything that we may face. We have a God who's greater than anything that you may face. Listen, I realize that in this room, there's 300 plus people. There's some of you students who you come from a great family homes and situations. Some of you come from broken homes and broken situations. Guess what? Jesus can reach those in the great situations just like He can reach those in the broken situations, right? There's some of us in here who come from not very much. Our family struggle to get by. Our family struggle to put food on the table and gas in the cars right now, right? Can I get a witness? And there's some of us here who your families are blessed upon blessed. Listen, let me tell you right now that the enemy does not pick favorites. He, no matter your background, no matter your upbringing, no matter where you're at in life, you have an enemy called Satan, called the devil, right? And he comes to seek, kill, and destroy. And we serve a God who is the God of the breakthrough and the God that meets our needs and is right there with us. Knowing that, we know the enemy. Once we know the enemy, once we know what we're fighting, once we know who we're fighting, we know his weakness, and that weakness name is Jesus. The next thing we have to know is we have to know the coach. We got to know the coach. How many guys are in athletics? Got to know the coach. Listen, let me ask you this. Do you know your coach's voice? You know, you can be on the football, any football players. You can be on the football field, and he can be 50 yards away, and that coach goes to screaming your name. Guess what? Your ears perk up because you know he's talking to you. And a crowd of people yelling and screaming, rip their legs off! Right? We got any Ada people here today? You from Ada? Oh, I'm a McAllister Buffalo man. I was going to say Potat. But anyway, in a crowd of people screaming and shouting, you know the voice of your coach over everybody else screaming. The same way when the voices of the world are so loud and blinding to our ears, right? They're deafening to our ears. We have to have that laser focus knowing our coach's voice. And that coach is God. We need to listen to the voice of God. In that video we watched before, Rocky Balboa's in the corner and he's like, I can't believe he done broke my nose again. Right? That was a really bad impersonation, I know. But he said he broke my nose again, and his coach, the old man, he stumbled and said, listen, he's just a man. He's just a man. You can take him. You can beat him. You're a greasy, fast, 200-pound Italian tank, is what he said. That's what he told Rocky, and Rocky got up, and we know how it is. Rocky just wins and obliterates him, and Adrian, right? Listen, Rocky is a 200-pound Italian tank. I need you to look at your neighbor this morning and tell him, my friend, you are a 200-pound Italian tank. Now add this tag on it for Jesus. Amen. Can I get a witness in the house this morning? Listen, there's a term in boxing, there's a term in fighting that coaches will shout, that the corner men, right? The cheat second. We got any fighting, boxing people terminology in here? Listen, when you're fighting, when you're boxing, there's some terms. One of the terms that they use, your chief second is your coach. He's running the corner. He's telling, get your corner man hyped up, ready to stitch you up, ready to get you going, right? And when the chief second hollers out, he'll shout orders, right? And those orders are, get those gloves up. He's like, hit him with some body shots. Hit him with some head shots, right? Put some distance between you. Get a breather. Or he'll say something like this. Be first. Look at your neighbor and say, be first. Be first. Be first means that you hit your opponent before they had a chance to make contact. We're pretty self-explanatory, right? Be first. God is telling you today, be first. All throughout Scripture, we read where David says that I'm going to hide God's word in my heart, not after I sin so that I can overcome that sin. But David said, I'm going to hide God's word in my heart so that I might not, what? Sin against God. Listen, he wasn't hiding God's word in his heart because he got in a jam and he needed a help up to get out of the situation he was in. He was hiding God's word in his heart so that he may not sin against God. You and I, God is telling us today to be first, to hide God's word in our heart. Listen, we're only as strong as the word that we have within us. Amen. And I believe that's why we have a bunch of weak-minded Christians today. We've gotten pacified with the Bible up on the screen. Right? We've gotten pacified with our Bible apps. Come on. Listen, I love it. Maybe I love you, Virgin, and going through your Bible plans. But I think all of our leaders would agree today that there is just an anointing, there's a power, there's something that happens when we crack open the written word of God and we allow God's word without any distractions and Snapchat going off and Instagram and TikTok, right? When we get alone with God with the printed word of God and we crack it open and we begin to pour into our lives and allow God to pour into our life, there's a spiritual breakthrough that happens in our heart and in our minds where we're filling ourselves with the presence and the word of God. To when God says, be first, we already know, I'm going to hide God's word in my heart. I'm going to stand on the rock that is higher than I, that Jesus Christ is the rock of my salvation. Right? When we hide God's word in our heart, we're able to be first and to strike blows to the enemy before the enemy kicks us down. Look at your neighbor and say, be first. The third thing that we need to know is we need to know this right here. We need to know your weakness. We need to know your weakness. We know the enemy. Whoa, that was dangerous. See, we got to know our boundaries. We know the enemy. We know our coach. And then we need to know our weaknesses. If we're real honest, every one of us knows where we're weak. Because it's the same things that we keep struggling with. It's the same things that we keep having fear about in our lives. It's the same bouts of depression. It's the same addictions. It's the same circle of friends that we keep going back to, even though we know that they're not good for us. It's the same relationship that we've been striving after when we know that relationship is leading us down the wrong road. We need to know our weaknesses. Know your weaknesses. We need to know that the enemy keeps waving in your face your weakness. Enemy knows where you're weak. That's why he keeps bringing it to you. He's waving in your face. Like anybody ever took like a dog toy to a dog or like a cat and they just, or a cat and they watch the laser, like pew, and they just jump across the room and you like hit, put it on the wall so that they run into the wall. Pew, pew. Right? Anybody else? Yeah, I'm a dog person, if you can't tell. But that's what the enemy does to us. He's like, ooh, come check this out, little kitty kitty, right? And 9 times out of 10, you and I, we're dumb enough, we're going to follow that laser. Until the point where we run smack into the wall and we're flat down on our face. Oh, what happened? Oh, idiot, it's because you're chasing the laser. Instead of having laser focus on God and God's word and what his plan is for your life, you're chasing your weaknesses. You're chasing things of the world. And I want to challenge us today to know your weaknesses. Know that you can't battle your weaknesses and those weak places in your life by yourself. You see, a lot of times what happens, we as believers, we think, oh, I got Jesus. I can get it. It's okay. I'll make it through you. Right? Some really good vocals coming up here. You guys are don't even know what's going on up here. But no, we're like, we'll make it through. I got it on my own. And what happens? You don't make it very good. You're a smart cookie, Jamin. But listen, we need to have laser focus on the things of God and not God's word. Because that's where we find strength. I want to ask you this morning, what are your weaknesses? Listen, I think about one of the most beautiful things in the Christian walk is baptism. One of the most beautiful things is baptism. And I don't know how you do it at your church, but our church, We like to celebrate when somebody's getting baptized, baby, because that is a representation on the outside of what has happened on the inside. And man, if we're going to cheer at the football game on Friday night, by God, when somebody gets saved and they get baptized declaring it to the world, we're going to celebrate. We're going to party it up. And so we celebrate it. But baptism is a beautiful picture, right? Because when you're dunked under the water, it's symbolism for being dead to the old you. And when you come out of the water, you are made new in Jesus Christ. Just like Jesus come out of the tomb, he was made whole. He was fully God and fully man. But when he come out of that tomb, baby, he was shining bright like a diamond. Right? Shining bright like a diamond. Listen, you and I are created to shine. And look, baptism is a beautiful picture. We're immersed and we come out of that water. The old you is left behind, and it's a representation of the new you that is springing forth to new life in Jesus. And so we need to remember that day of your baptism, that you were showing the world what God was doing in your life and in your heart. But in reality, we die to our flesh. We die to our weaknesses each and every day. Know what our weaknesses are. What are the temptations that are tripping you up in life? What are those things, those wells that you keep going back to, but there's nothing springing forth from it in your life? What are those habits? What are those things that are tripping you up? What are those weaknesses? What are ways that you can, in our group last night, we were talking about this exact thing, about keep struggling with the same things, and what are some practical applications that we can do in our lives to overcome those thorns in the flesh and these things that keep tripping us up, keeping us weak, right? And of course, it was like the church camp answers that, well, we can pray and just give it to God, glory to Him. And I'm like, yes! Duh, we're at church camp. Obviously, we know we got to give it to God, okay? But give me some real, what are some practical ways that we can overcome weaknesses in our life? And I think one of the best things that we can do, young men, raise your hand if you're a young man in here. I know that there might be some confusion, but yes, young men, raise your hand. Listen, in today's society, it's important that young men have people who can keep them in check. Ooh, a little too real for you this morning, Ken Wiles. Listen, check it out. If we're really wanting to fight this fight, if we're serious about fighting this enemy that's fighting us, we need somebody who can shout at us, be first! Put your gloves up, right? We need people that can speak into our lives and say, body shot, body shot. Right? We need people who can speak into our lives that we trust, that can help navigate this hard life, this fight of life that we are facing. Yeah. Young ladies, you need godly women in your life to tell you, hey, don't be a floozy. Find you a woman who loves God and model after her. Ask her, how do I be a woman of integrity in this generation, in this world? I want to challenge all of our men and women leaders in here today. I want to challenge you to put the churchy things that we're supposed to say aside, and let's begin to be real and authentic with our students. Because if we can't address real situations that they're facing, we've lost them already. And we need to be the leaders of this generation who are going to encourage them and challenge them and tell them, get your head out of your butt. Be first. Did you read your Bible today, young man? Hey, bro, have you spent time with God today? Let me pray for you. Let me lay hands on you and encourage you. Listen, we got to start taking this thing serious. Why? Because we are in a fight to the death. But the battle's already won. Amen, Camp Well? Hey, I want to encourage you this morning to know your enemy, to know your coach, and to know your weaknesses. Throughout the day, I want you to think about that. What does that mean to know my enemy, to know my coach, and to know my weaknesses? throughout the day, I want you to think about that and to pray about that and ask God in times of just downtime or times where you're alone in your bunk and you're sweating and you're sticking to the mattress and it goes, right? Anybody else do a turnover, you know, to switch sides at 4 o'clock in the morning and you hear this? Is your back sticking to the mattress? Listen, I want to challenge you to really think and ponder in your mind. That's an okie word, isn't it? Ponder about. Listen, think about what it means to know your enemy, to know your coach, to listen to your coach, and to know your weaknesses. We gon' rise, we gon' shine. I need you to fight for me. I know you're my therapy.